My partner is Sandra Campbell, Associate Minister of Unity Worldwide. I serve on the board here at Unity World Headquarters. And I'm the Executive Director of Unity Urban Ministerial School, which is right here. My market called on me. I'm also a member of IAMU, Independent Alliance of Ministers in the Unity. Martha called on me, I think, because of the role that Martha and Glenn played in establishing Unity Urban Ministerial School. It was Glenn who established the first scholarship with money that they raised from the sale of a building in St. Louis when they took over the church there. They tied that to the Urban School, and the Urban School has been flourishing ever since. So I'm grateful to follow in the footsteps of Reverend Dr. Glenn Mosley and his sister in Christ, the late Reverend Dr. Ruth Mosley, who founded the Urban School, and they call themselves brother and sister. Brother and sister from another mother. So Martha asked me if I would read the eulogy. But before I do, bear with me, because this message is strictly for all of you who were close to Glenn, especially for Martha. And I'm sure you've heard the story, but when she asked me to do this, I couldn't help but think about the story. Because when a loved one leaves and crosses over, we feel such a sense of loss. There's such a big, deep hole that's left. And we have to figure out how to fill that hole. So the story is told by Franz Kafka, the story of Kafka and the doll. I hope you enjoy the story as much as it's inspired me. Today's daily word is inspiration. So hopefully today you will receive something of inspiration from this celebration, from Glenn's life, and from all those, especially Reverend Strickland, who are going to share with us some memories of Glenn's life. The story is told that in the fall of 1923, Franz Kafka, who was a German fiction writer, who always wrote dark fiction, encountered a little girl in the park while he was doing his daily walk. She had lost her doll, and she was crying inconsolably, as we do when we lose someone we love. Kafka offered to help her look for the doll and arranged to meet her at the same location the following day. Unable to find the doll, he composed a letter from the doll and read it to her when they met. "Please don't mourn me," he wrote. "I have gone on a trip to see the world. I will write you of my adventures." This was the beginning of many letters that Kafka would write to the little girl. Each time he and the little girl met, he would read her another letter, carefully composed, of the imagined adventures of her beloved doll. The little girl was comforted. When the meetings came to an end, Kafka presented her with a doll. The doll obviously looked different than the original one, and there was a letter attached that explained, "My travels have changed me." Many years later, the now grown-up girl found a letter stuffed into an unnoticed crevice in the cherished replacement doll. In summary, it read, "Everything that you love, you will eventually lose. But in the end, love will return in a different form." I think that is the most precious reminder to us that life is eternal and does not end. It goes on. So to Martha, love will return in a different form. Reverend Glenn Mosley lived here in my, where I live, at least up along with Martha, passed away on January 25th at a research hospital in Kansas City from COVID pneumonia. Glenn was born on a farm near Akron, Ohio, to James G. Mosley and Mildred Wiseman Mosley. He was born on May 23rd, 1935. As a teenager, he heard spirits call through a line from a song, "I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord." He was ordained at Unity as a Unity minister at age 23, probably one of the youngest Unity ministers, and dedicated his life to Unity ministry. He held two doctorates and master's degrees and was a lifelong learner. He was a member of the board of directors of the Association of Unity Churches, now Unity Worldwide Ministries, and served as president and CEO from 1985 to 2005. In his 60-plus years in ministry, Glenn served ministries in Flushing, New York, Manhattan, New York, Detroit, Michigan, Akron, Ohio, Sheboygan, Wisconsin, and St. Louis, Missouri, and Vancouver, British Columbia. He was friends with Sir John Templeton, served as a judge for the Templeton Prize for Progress in Religion, and served the John Templeton organizations on several boards. Glenn leaves to cherish his wonderful, amazing life. His parents and siblings preceded him in death. He leaves to cherish his wonderful wife. His children would mostly see Junior, but Tracy Mullen, Susan Hoffman, and Robert DePue, along with 8 grandchildren and 12 great-grandchildren. Glenn lived a remarkable life. And I have to go back to the song that Stephanie sang, "Beautiful are the feet. Beautiful are the feet and footsteps in which we travel." So I'm grateful to have known Glenn, to have had a chance to talk to him on many occasions, and to have him at my ordination ceremony in Detroit. So with that, I would like to turn it over to Reverend John Strickland. He's going to continue to take us down memory lane and celebrating the life of one great man, Reverend Dr. Glenn Mosley.
So nice to be here. This time of graduation, that's how I see it, it's graduation. And it's also difficult. You know, the difficult services you do are those that you've been a friend with. But a long, long time. I remember when I was James Bennett Freeman's understudy, and Martha Smock, the editor of Daily Word for so many years, made her transition. I was sitting next to Jim before he went up to the lectern to give his remarks, and he said, "John, I don't think I can do this. If I get up there and I can't, I'm going to point to you, and you come up and you do it." I'm sitting there like this. So I'm seeing my teachers and colleagues. You know, the person who taught me how to answer the phone in silent unity. So I'm thinking, if I don't get through this, I'm going to call you up, Phil, and I'll point to you. One of the things that happened to me, and sometimes happens, and I don't claim to be a mystic or anything like that, but at a point between sleeping and waking, I had this vision of a ridge crossing from this land to a gleaming city on the other side. And I saw Glenn's spirit soaring over that to throngs of people, family and friends, and colleagues, to welcome him and celebrate him to the other side. I was able to get his attention for a moment. I said, "God, what would you like me to say?" And he said, "Tell the story." I said, "What story?" But he went on, so I still don't know what story he wanted me to tell. But there's stories that I do want to share, and that I just learned this from. Apparently, everybody may know this. That first of all, we were friends, and we ministered one to another. And you know, sometimes happens in unity, we have more than one marriage. One ends, and we're grieving, and two ministers to the minister. So we kind of ministered to each other. The marriage had ended. And he was thinking he wanted to try again. But this time there would be an examination for the prospect. he had in mind that he would invite 10 women to a Kansas City Chiefs game. And the first one who knew what the game was all about was he would marry them. Martha was the first one. I had many conversations with him about the courtship and how he loved Martha, and it was just complete for the first time in his life, and that's a wonderful thing. Now, I also thought there were many hats he wore. So he was the head of the Association of Unity Churches, Unity Worldwide Ministries, minister on the board of Templeton. My goodness. You think about that, Sir John Templeton, one of the wealthiest people in the world who loved unity, and the relationship they had brought in financial support. We would have him sometimes at our convention and he'd speak to us. So there were all these hats that he wore, and there were his father and grandfather. Remember him telling me one time walking along the lake with a grandchild, and he said, "Oh, look at the duck and the little boy." Who could hardly speak? He said, "Emmer Coots, Papa. Emmer Coots." says, I ask his son, he's telling you those aren't ducks, those are coots, which is a different waterfowl than a duck. Now, who knew that? And, you know, with his two doctorates and all, he didn't know that. One time I was going to Edinburgh. I'm part Scottish, he's part Scottish. And he said to me, time to get to Edinburgh, see if you can find a statue of one of my ancestors. His name is Sir James Young Sinton. He was one of the first ones to use anesthesia in dealing with humans. Thinking, man, how am I going to find a statue? And you know what I did? I was walking down the street near the statue. I said, what must have won? Sure enough, it was. So I took a picture of that. What are the chances of going to Edinburgh and finding the statue? So, neat stories. And he was a friend. More than the president, chief executive officer, friend. I had times of meeting. He had times of meeting. Who do you talk to in those times? There are times, I see my friend Debbie there. And we as a board, and we had this wonderful idea of doing a convention on a cruise ship.
Yeah.
We didn't know nothing about nothing. Excuse my southern dialect. We suddenly sold out the whole ship. Oh my gosh, that was so wonderful. What we didn't do is have a clause in there that if you wanted to back out, it was going to cost you. So all these people that put $100 down or something backed out within a month. And we lost a ton of money. And I think this was one of the great moments for me in Unity Worldwide Ministries. When all was said and done, the board came together, we were going to follow our swords. And everybody said, you know, we didn't know what we didn't know. And we had a healing circle and a time of grieving and a time of saying words that you really don't expect clergy to say. We needed to get back. And we just said to the whole conference, what they want. We made a mistake. And you know what they said? We forget. And we thought they were just clean our clock, maybe ask us to make up the $500,000 deficit that we just created. It's a great cruise, though, wasn't it? and we recovered, and we did more cruises, and we understood. You can't cancel out with 30 days to do it. But those things where we came together, we don't have to do everything exactly right all the time. Sometimes it seems that in clergy or the Association of Unity Worldwide Ministry, that's the expectation. You ever notice that? You know, I was talking to Shad, who now sits in that chair, and I said, you know, I've said to people that ministry is a terrible profession, but a magnificent calling. And I said, it's even more so in the position you're sitting in. And for them to have done that for 20 years, my word. And we had some great times together. One of the times that was important for him to minister to me, when my minister from Atlanta, Jay Dickman, passed. And when someone passes in the saddle, meaning they're an active minister, he had a heart attack and a car accident, and he died at Christmas time. My word, that leaves a congregation. And so I went back there, and he went back to speak. And this was a glorious moment because I do think that people from the other side can give us a message. And at that church, at Christmas time, they collected teddy bears, and then they would give them out to organization people that might not have a present. One of those, in the midst of this solemn time, and the tears were green and they were flowing, somebody squeezed one and it started going, here comes that book, here comes that book. That's that book. And it didn't know how to stop it. You know, it's like this thing. So I was trying to open this up, go broke, the battery's out, this sort of thing. And it kind of broke the spell. And then I remember, he told Martha about that as well. What a great moment. I sort of feel Jay, he was, and I mean this affectionately, he was my relative. He could be a rascal at times. I'm just pretty sure. Somehow, he knew that some of those squeeze out there. Well, I just was handed this poem. I'm going to share a couple of poems or things from literature. This is from an unlikely poet in Unity, Stephen Cole. You know Stephen? I never knew he could write. So I've only had a chance to just now read this, but it was important to read this, and I want to do it well. And it was in honor of last 20 years. 20 years, it is not too long for the executive to sing a song. The melody was an ascending scale of notes and words that came without fail. Our CEO took up the baton, a maestro whose rhythm was impeccably strong. His orchestra was chosen from the instruments they played. To be sure, the conductor would have his day. He played his song wherever he went, to an audience of ministers who gave it up for Lent. Someone knew what to play that to. His favorite temple had a ton on the end. Temple, ton on the end. It, music has a way of making you his friend. Every good maestro has a cast of support. It began with Martha, who will not hesitate to retort. There's Joanne and Carl, who organized the band, and Barbara at least to give everyone a hand. We don't forget Beth, who's really in control. Now that we're sure from the depths of our soul. Although bagpipes would be his instrument of choice, his greatest gift is his commanding voice. When a song's off key, there's still a smile on his face because he knows he's dealing with the human race. And his song is not over, his melody not done. You see, this maestro will not ride in its setting sun. There's more music to write, more songs to sing, more instruments to tune, maybe even a flame. Wherever he goes, there'll be music, you see, because the song he sings will set people free. So give him a hand, a standing ovation, something that will express our appreciation for a virtuoso performance from his steady hand. Leaves us standing in awe of the leader of a man. That's sweet. So, I like these words from Julius Caesar, Shakespeare. His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. I also like these words, clothing lines from Tennyson's Ulysses. You may have heard them. It's not common for them to be recited at a graduation. This is a celebration. It is a graduation. I mean, clearly, he has graduated from this plane to the next plane. And Tennyson speaks of Ulysses, who's lived a long and colorful life and had great voyages in this. And at some point, he says, come, my friend, 'tis not too late to seek a newer world. Push off and sitting well in order. Smite the sound of the furrows, for my purpose holds to sail beyond the sunset and the baths of all the western stars until I die. It may be the gulfs will wash us down. It may be we shall touch the happy isles and see the great Achilles whom we knew. Though much is taken, much abides, and though we are not now that strength which in old days moved earth and heaven, that which we are, one equal temper of heroic hearts made weak by time and fate, but strong in will to strive, seek, to find, and not to yield. So that was my friend, and he wore many hats, as I said, but not the favorite, but one of them. Was this guy. And I picked this up on the way here. And I just want to say, let me stand away from my phone. This was a man. And he is and shall be. But now he's in spirit form. Good work to do. God bless you.
Follow up with some of this title, My Tribute.
say thanks for the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels, the morning's praise, my gratitude, all that I am and ever want to be.
Sure, some of you have many good memories, Uncle Ned. Not very long ago, I had the wonderful opportunity to help my mother make her transition at the age of 101 in November. And I promised my mom the last word she said to me that were audible was, "I want to go home." Now remember the words of Ram Dass, who said, "We're all just walking each other home." So we get the opportunity today to share with each other the abundant blessings that Glenn has brought into our lives. So if there's anyone who's been on the walk with Glenn, with Martha, with Buzz, others, to please come forward and take about 2 minutes and share your expressions of love about Glenn and your experience. Anyone? I don't know about you, but I can feel Glenn's presence. My name is Sonia Thompson. I'm a Unity minister who had the privilege of serving in the Army for 22 years as a Unity minister. And Glenn was remarkable because anytime I would be overseas serving someplace, I would come back here and go into his office, and he would be so supportive and interested in the military, what it was like. And I'll never forget that. It was a constant. And Tom Tharp was another one along the way. He was always interested in, well, what's happening in the life of soldiers? What's Unity like? And how are you serving? What is that ministry like? And when I was commissioned, Glenn played a role in that. And it was wonderful to bring me on duty as a second lieutenant. And that was a long time ago. But this is a great, great faith. And he was, I think, a premier person of what Unity stands for. And Martha, bless you, you were such a team. And Martha looks younger and more beautiful every day. And I know it had to be a great influence with Glenn. So Glenn, God bless you for being there. And through you, supporting a lot of soldiers and their families and keeping me going. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
We're all shy. I know you're not.
Hello, everyone. I'm Reverend Marge Dale. Glenn and I were colleagues, and we were also close friends. Over the many years that we served together in Unity, we worked on many projects together. And what I loved about Glenn was his openness. He was always open to hearing other perspectives. And as Sandra said earlier, he was always interested in learning. Now, I remember when we initiated a management training at Unity Village, Glenn called me up one day and said, can our staff attend those classes? I said, well, of course. The next thing I knew, Glenn was there. He was participating. He always loved to keep learning and growing, and I love that about him. But the thing that, over the years, many as I say, we worked on many projects together, but the thing that I remember and the most, that meant the most to me, that I hold in my heart to this day, is when my younger brother was battling for his life, struggling for his life with a rare form of leukemia. I guess I had mentioned it to Glenn. We were at a meeting or something one day, having a dinner break, and he asked me about my brother, and I told him what was going on. And Glenn was a healer. He was a healer. He believed in natural healing. He taught classes on that. Once a healing color touch, was that it, Martha, what it was called? Yes. He even taught classes at the University of Kansas, some of their medical students. So he really believed and was committed to healing. And he said to me about my brother, he said, well, if he's willing, I would like to go and see what I can do, if I can work on him. And I said, well, Glenn, he isn't here. He lives in Houston. And he said, then I'll go there. Without a moment's hesitation, he was ready to go and do what he could for someone he didn't even know. And that just touched me so deeply. It worked out that wasn't necessary for him to go, but still the fact that he was willing to do that just touched me. And he told me everything I needed to know about going Mosley. So God bless you, Glenn. Godspeed on your way. Love you.
Hi, good afternoon. I am actually scholar from the East. That's Dr. Glenn Mosley used to call me. I didn't plan to stand up to talk to you, but instead, when I was at home and thinking about last 20 plus years in Glenn, yes, I made a short letter to tribute to Glenn. So again, I was really prompted to come and share with you. I consider 20 plus years working with Dr. Glenn Mosley. It's a great blessing If Glenn taught me vividly, clearly how to live a meaningful, successful, and professional life. When he started in 1985, and he hired me, I started working, and he hired Mosley too. He hired first two people. One, the guy, his spiritual spouse, and he became my spiritual leader, mentor. At that time, he asked me some special work. At that time, association investing a lot of money for computer system. At that time, 85, is considering very few people know how to set up up and running or integrating accounting system, database into Intel system. And he must have called many, many places. So he found me, I was working in KC, and teaching computer in science in accounting. So I started working, and week after week, sometime, 15 hours a day, and then less than 2 weeks of that run, and he gave me total trust from then on. So we came here, and I learned with that experience connection, I learned definition of a successful life, successful spiritual life is about. I learned from him. And also I found that the following characteristic on Dr. Mosley. Number one, he's the personal, both weak to the weak and strong to the strong. That is, I noticed, I experienced. He was a personal coach who pursued the right path with an indomitable spirit. At the same time, he was full of sympathy and empathetic compassion to the weak. I know him, I experienced. Second, who can listen to everything with tremendous patience. Not the patient. So when he had a chance to sit and talk, he is listening. As you know, there's a lot of broken because I was made in Korea. I'm broken. You talk about special professional decision making. If one mistake is going to have a lot of bad consequences, he was listening. Listening. No one is probably make it short or what the point he never said. So what's your vision? Third is a person who studied, worked all his life for truth, his passion for learning a new and advanced idea was endless and unlimited. As again, his introduction to me. The one master, one day, he came to my office. Do you happen to have some finance textbook? I said, not really, why? He's pursuing MBA, even CEO and president, meeting after meeting, and such busy schedule, traveling church to church, and endless, incoming trouble. Many, many years ago, I want to talk with him. Nevertheless, he was in the MBA. So I gave him my textbook. So I was wondering how he could be successful. Nevertheless, he did. So I knew he was a different person. So before I finish So let me read a poem written, happened to be in 1932. The poet is Elizabeth Swann. I believe this point could be totally suitable for Glenn Mosley. The title Do not stand in my grave and weep. Probably some of you have heard the word Korean folk singer and composed music and become, you know, one of the top, you know, is the song of the song. I'm not there. I do not sleep. I am a thousand wind that blows. I am a diamond glint on snow. I am the sunlight of whitened rain. I am a gentle orange rain. When you awaken in the morning, hush. I am the sweet uplifting brush of pied bird and serpent fly. I'm the soft star that shines. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there. I do not die. It's dead. It never died, never perished. At this moment, I knew somewhere in the sky, in the mountain, the wind, and his whispering to us. Never give up. Just keep on moving on, moving on. Glenn, may God bless you. May God bless you or so. Have a successful life. A successful life. Still going on. Thank you.
So I'm sitting back there trying to decide whether to get up or not. There are four of us here now, we can. Martha was our student minister for 3 years, and we all got to know her, and we all got also got to meet Glenn because, you know, we had to talk a lot. But the one gift, and also I'm a licensed Unity teacher, just on the side. But the gift that he gave me was when he taught the healing hover touch classes. I come from a mathematics background, and my father was a chemical engineer, so I don't know much about it. I'm done. I can actually do it. He taught me to really push the limit. As Unity tells us, there are none. And that was the gift that I always remember him for.
Does anyone else please come up if you want to speak? The story lives on, and these stories that have been shared, starting with Reverend Strickland, are powerful stories. Every one of your stories is bringing Glenn to the present moment, where he's never left. So when we bring that story up in our minds, and we live the experiences that we've had with Glenn, whether they were long or short, we recognize the fact that life never ends. As long as we keep that story and we keep reminding ourselves, we understand that there's not that much distance between us and the other side. I think James Philip Freeman said it best. He has put on invisibility. Dear Lord, I cannot see. But this I know, although the road ascends and passes from my sight, that there will be no light. That you will take him gently by the hand and lead him on along the road of life that doesn't end, and he will find it is not dusk, but dawn. Our life did not begin with birth. And that's hard for us to conceive, isn't it? Baby's born, and that's life. You hold that baby in your arms, that's life. But that life did not begin with birth. It is not of the earth. And this that we call death, it is no more than the opening and closing of a door. And in your house, how many rooms must be beyond this one where we rest momently? And the great poet, James Philip Freeman, wrote this after the death of his wife, and he was mourning her leaving. He said, "Dear Lord, I thank you for the faith that frees, the love that knows it cannot lose its own, the love that looking through the shadow sees that you and I and Glenn are ever one. We're all just walking each other home." So now we'll conclude this celebration for now. We get to continue to celebrate Glenn's life and your stories in your heart. Don't let the celebration end, because you'll think of other things and you'll think, I wish I had remembered that story, because I know John has probably 100 stories. And I'm sorry I didn't get your name, but I know you have 100 stories. And everybody who stood up there can think of more things about Glenn and how special he was in your life. So when you bring that up, just know that's Glenn whispering, "Hey, I told you to tell that story. If you need to tell the one, I want you to tell them," right? So grief and loss are ubiquitous. The way toward healing is to look at how love returns in a different form. How healing it is to hold this conviction that love will return. It is our job to recognize it in its new form. And it reminds us, if Glenn were here right now to speak to us, he'd say, "Live your life to the fullest." That's exactly what he did. There's a song that I learned growing up in the Baptist church, and at funerals I would hear this all the time. And the words of the song are, "May the works I've done speak for me. May the life I live speak for me. When I'm resting in my grave and there's nothing more to be said, may the works I've done speak for me." Glenn can't speak to us right now, but I guarantee you, his word has spoken today. Glenn is very present and will always remain right wherever we are. Whenever we think of him, he's calling on us, saying, "Remember this story. Don't forget to tell the story." Because in the end, it's all one big story, and we're part of the players in that story. Stephanie announces.
Actually, it is Stephanie, Alex, and y'all. This is a song that most of you probably already know it through the words. So we get to that part of the chorus that's repetitive. If you don't start getting up, I'm going to invite you to get up and to sing, because this is the celebratory part that will lead into.
Recognize it now. Sing it sweet song. Yeah.